The Lord be with you. I'm Pastor Matt Smith from Bethlehem Evangelical Lutheran Church in Lansing, Michigan, and this is worship for the second Sunday in Lent, March 13th, 2022. Today is also Mission Sunday for us, and so we will receive a special second offering for the Lutheran Lakota Shared Ministries at the Pine Ridge Reservation. Today's service will include hymns, songs, and an anthem led by, members of our choir, and an anthem solo from Lisa Whitman, a children's sermon, and my sermon titled Family, along with readings and prayers from our assisting minister today, Nancy Coldereed. If you have not yet filled out our brief Returning to Worship survey, the link for you to scan with your smartphone is up on the screen, and it was also part of the announcements. We'd like to have everyone fill this out by Monday so that when our council meets this week, we will have your input from all of you for our next steps for returning to, our next steps out of the pandemic for what communion might look like and our fellowship time. Our Lenten offering envelope this year that was in your March newsletter, our Lenten offering is going to Lutheran Immigration and Refugee Services, specifically to help refugees from Ukraine. If you are watching this on YouTube, our cameras are being installed. All the equipment has arrived for us to begin to live stream our worship on Sunday morning rather than having a recorded worship service. But I'm obviously recording for this service. I'll record again next week, and following that, I will not be available for the weekend of the 27th to produce a worship service, and Holy Week services will not be fully produced. So hopefully we'll be live streaming by then so that you can take part in those festive services. Lent Wednesdays, we continue with a devotional reflection online on YouTube at 7 p.m. These reflections are between 16 to 18 minutes. So 16 to 18 minutes of your time on Wednesday evening at 7 o'clock. Our theme is letting go. And this Wednesday, March 16th, we will focus on letting go of fear and anxiety as we continue our Lenten journey. And we've heard from a few folks who have watched this, or watched last week, that it was particularly meaningful to them. So we do hope you'll join us for those. Though we sometimes doubt and often resist God's desire to protect and save us, our God persists. In holy baptism, God's people have been called and gathered into God-initiated relationship that endures. Lent provides the church with a time and a tradition in which we seek God's face again, returning to God. Lent provides another occasion to behold the God of our salvation in the face of the Blessed One, who comes in the name of the Lord. Please stand as you are able as we begin with our call to worship.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God, we know a little of what you're like. You are our light and our salvation. You are our stronghold and our protector. We don't need to live in fear anymore. Instead, we will live in your presence. We will live in the peaceful shelter of your holy wings. God, you lift us up when others try to pull us down. We're going to sing joyful, praise-making songs to you. We're going to stay with you. We'll never give up. We're going to worship you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Our opening hymn is, In the Cross of Christ I Glory. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. God, gather us as your scattered people into the unity of the body of Christ. Gather us as your broken people into the healing power of your loving arms. Gather us with all our regrets, laments, and discouragement into the peaceful shelter of your holy wings. Meet us here as we worship you in Jesus' name. This we pray through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. He lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever. Amen. Now we invite children to come focus on their screens for our worship talk for children as we sing, Lord, I lift your name on high. Well, good morning. Thank you for coming up to pay attention today to our worship talk for kids. I brought a chicken with me today. Really, I brought a chicken. Well, it's really tiny. It's kind of hard to see. Hopefully you can see that. This little chicken, well, this is actually a Lego chicken. And it's from a building that I'm working on for my winter village for Christmas, but I thought I'd bring that in, this little chicken. Have you ever played with a chicken or been around chickens much? My wife Michelle, her parents, people who live behind their house, they have chickens, at least one, and this chicken likes to come over into their yard. And so we've given a name. Luna is its name. It's pretty friendly, and it certainly will eat almost anything that we throw down for it to eat. Things that we know, of course, are good for a chicken's diet. But it's kind of fun to play with. But one thing to know about birds like chickens or ducks or geese is how protective they are of their young, of their baby chicks or goslings. I think it was last spring, I remember being with one of our members here at Bethlehem, or from Bethlehem, and we saw a Canada goose who was leading her young across a street, and there were two groups, there were two different sizes of chicks. There were about four smaller ones, and then they were followed by five larger ones, but they were all lined up in a row, and she was making sure they got across the road safely. Now, she had these two different kinds of chicks because probably something happened to the mother of the larger ones, and she adopted them, or it could have been the mother of the smaller ones, and she adopted them into her family, so they were all one. Well, I'm talking about chickens this morning because the Bible tells us that one day Jesus looked over the city of Jerusalem and he cried. And he said, "Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how often I have longed to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing." Jesus was crying out of sadness over Jerusalem. Jerusalem was a very special place for God's chosen people, the Hebrew people. But when Jesus came, the people of Jerusalem rejected him. Jesus wants to gather all people together under his protection. Like a mother hen, Jesus calls all his children to come to him so that he can shelter and protect them, even adopting children who we might not think are his. Jesus invites all of us. Even though Jerusalem rejected Jesus, he never stopped calling his children. If only some of Jesus' children came back, well, he doesn't stop calling. If some, he keeps calling. If almost all, he keeps calling. He won't stop calling until all his children have come back to him. Well, today, along with the chicks, we should listen. We should listen for Jesus' calling today. So let us pray. Repeat after me, okay? Dear Jesus, thank you for loving us so much that you keep calling us until we have all come back to you. Amen. Well, thank you for coming to pay attention today, and I hope to see you all again soon.
Our first reading this morning is from the Old Testament book of Genesis, chapter 15. Verses 1 through 6. God had promised Abram land and descendants, but Abram remains childless. In our passage, God comes with the covenant promise once more to steady Abram in his uncertainty. A reading from Genesis. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, You have given me no offspring, and so a slave born in my house is to be my heir. But the word of the Lord came to him, This man shall not be your heir. No one put you, your very own issue shall be your heir. He brought him outside and said, Look towards the heaven and count the stars, if you are able to count them. Then he said to him, So shall your descendants be. And he believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
We are turning for to hear you. You are merciful and kind. So to anger rich in blessing and with love to us inclined.
Jesus has a very clear message for the Pharisees who want him to run away and hide. He will not be deterred. He will not be distracted. He will never give up. The Holy Gospel according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. At that very same hour, some Pharisees came and said to Jesus, Get away from here, for Herod wants to kill you. He said to them, Go and tell that fox for me. Listen, I am casting out demons and performing cures today and tomorrow, and on the third day I finish my work. Yet today, tomorrow, and the next day I must be on my way, because it is impossible for a prophet to be killed outside of Jerusalem. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it. How often I have desired to gather your children together, as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you were not willing. See, your house is left to you, and I tell you, you will not see me until the time comes when you say, Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. I bring you grace, peace, and love in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Family. Family. Some people have a good experience with family, and for others, family might not have been the best place for them growing up. And the truth is, family can be and is both. And it's when the negative experiences begin to outweigh the positive, or the positive begin to outweigh the negative, that people have a positive, begin to create a positive or negative connotation with the word family. And especially because people can have such a negative connotation, having had a bad experience with family, I've even heard people suggest that the church shouldn't refer to itself as a family, as the family of faith, because that might alienate people who've had a bad experience with family. Well, my experience with family has been much more positive than negative, and so I'm more comfortable referring to the church as a family of faith. And my experience with this congregation, with this family of faith, with Bethlehem has certainly been much more positive than negative. This week, I was reviewing the 100 or so surveys that have been submitted so far to us concerning our COVID protocols as we try to figure out how to best begin to serve communion again in a more formal way, the way we have in the past, and making decisions about fellowship. Well, reading all these responses, looking over each one of the surveys, I was just overwhelmed with this amazing sense of peace and love. And as I read the responses, and that's not because everyone agreed. If you've not completed one yet, please do so as soon as possible so that we can have your opinion as the Congregation Council this week. It takes lots of different things into account as we try to decide the next steps forward. But what was overwhelming to me was what came through loud and clear in the comments that people were feeling. In the comments, they said they were feeling heard. It was clear. And they appreciated being heard. In this family of faith, we will not always agree. We'll certainly have different opinions, but we want everyone to be heard. And this is why we ask people to put their names on their surveys, because we want you to be heard. This is not about sharing anonymously what you may have heard or what you think you heard from some other people. We want to hear what you think. And about 97% of respondents so far have included their names. In this family of faith, we want to have open, honest communication. And I'm not sharing the results at this time because we are still hoping for a few more responses prior to our council meeting. But my two takeaways so far at this point have been that, one, not everyone agrees on what our next steps should be moving forward. But that's okay, because two, everyone who wants to be heard is being heard. So why am I talking about family today, bringing up a difficult issue where people may disagree within our family of faith? Well, today in Scripture, we hear the promise of the beginning of the family of faith. The Lord had already promised to Abraham, that his descendants would be many. At the beginning of chapter 12, God says to Abram, "I will make you a great nation." And at this point, he was 75 years old already. But he left home with his wife Sarah and his brother's son Lot and went where he was commanded to go, went in faith, trusting that God would lead them where God wanted them to go. And over the years of travel, they experienced famine and conflict, and Sarah couldn't bear him any children. And in our reading for today, God repeats the promise. The Lord brought Abraham outside and said, "Look up toward the heavens and count the stars. Count them if you are able." And then he said, "So shall your descendants be." And our promise-keeping God has kept this promise of a great family. Well, what does this family of faith look like today? The descendants of Abraham today are known as the three Abrahamic religions: Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. We are all three of us, all the same family, with one common ancestor, all under God, worshiping the same God. But we don't all get along very well. I'm sure I don't need to tell you all that. Not only is there conflict between the radical fringes of all three religions within our family of faith, there's even conflict within the individual religions. Instead of embracing each other as siblings, we fight with a limited view of who God is and what God has done and what God is doing in the world. And this, like so many conflicts, including what we're witnessing with the conflicts between the Russian Federation and Ukraine, this arises from a scarcity mentality where we think that there's not going to be enough of whatever resource to go around. But the good news is that God can and does love everyone, loves everyone, and there is more than enough. If God made as many people as God has, of course, God has also made sure that there would be enough resources to care for everyone, to feed the hungry. God can and does love everyone and has given us more than enough to go around. And there's more than enough of God's love to go around. Now, as Christians, we have a Trinitarian understanding of God as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But Scripture is clear. Paul, writing in Romans, is clear that all Israel will be saved. So the Jews are saved as well by God's grace. And in the Quran, in Islam, it is said that on the last day, Jews, Christians, and others will stand together with Muslims before God as one. It was God's intention from the beginning that all of Abraham's offspring, as numerous as the stars, would be one. And I wonder, as Christ looked out on Jerusalem and longed to gather his people under his protection, as a mother hen gathers her chicks, I wonder, is God now gazing upon all the descendants of Abraham and wishing to gather us together in safety? Gather us together as a family. I say yes. But look how we are refusing. As I mentioned before, it is the extreme edges of each of these religions where we in all three branches of the family where we see violence and a refusal to accept that God could love people as numerous as the stars. There are so many examples of extreme interpretations of faith that leads to violence that I wouldn't even know where to begin. But I believe that at the root of all of them, at the root of all these conflicts is a scarcity mentality. Fear that there won't be enough of God's love to go around. Fear that there won't be enough resources to go around. Trying to come through this pandemic, our fear and anxiety has pushed many of us to a place certainly of wanting security. If we didn't already want security, we want it so much more with the unknown of an airborne pathogen. We want security, and that means making sure that we have enough resources for us. Others can fend for themselves. And this fear, well, it's the opposite of faith. So what do we do? We're now long past the time when the sons and daughters of Abraham needed to learn to embrace our common humanity and our common identity as God's children. We need to respond with the faith of Abraham. And I know that that is easier said than done. The promise made to Abraham was unbelievable. But we are told he believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. As God repeats the promise that Abraham will be a great nation with as many descendants as there are stars above. Well, what changed here when he repeated the promise? What changed in this reading is simply Abraham's faith, his trust in God's promises. That made him righteous before God. So how can we show this same level of trust? What does being in God's family mean for us? How can we embrace the more difficult parts of this family of faith? Well, to begin to answer these questions, I want to take us back to where I started. We don't all agree at the congregational level, certainly not in the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America. We don't all agree at the synodical regional level. We don't all agree at the churchwide level. There are disagreements among the denominations. And there are conflicts within Israel, within Judaism, within Islam, and conflict between these descendants of Abraham. We need to recognize our common humanity. And that is probably easier to do when you're reading surveys within a congregation that is already among the same group of people. It's probably easier to do within a congregation to recognize our common humanity than it is to recognize the common humanity among the three great peoples descended from Abraham: Christians, Judaism, Jews, and Islam. But hearing the opinions of each other, though there is disagreement, well, this brings me such an overwhelming sense of peace and love, as I said. Well, this needs to be the next step. Listening. Recognizing our common humanity and then listening to each other. There is nothing to fear when we listen to each other. So, do not be afraid. Have faith. Trust in God. Trust in God's promises. And then, from that faith, work in your own small ways through listening to bring about glimpses of God's kingdom here on earth, sharing the love of God with everyone you meet. And to that, the people of God say, Amen. What does being in God's family mean to you? How can you embrace the more difficult parts of the family? And our hymn of the day is, Thy Holy Wings.
And let me rest secure.
Gathered into the safety in God's loving arms, let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And we continue in prayer.
Drawn close to the heart of God, we offer these prayers for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Heavenly Father, you gather the church into a community of mercy and grace. Bless the work of presiding Bishop Elizabeth Eaton and Bishop Craig Satterley as they continue to guide us through this pandemic. Strengthen the faith of Reverend Eric Johnson and the members of All Saints Lutheran Church in Mason. Instill a sense of purpose in Jason Mills as he continues his studies at Gettysburg Theological Seminary. Unify Christians around the globe in efforts to proclaim good news even in the face of opposition, and to protect those whose lives are endangered by the gospel. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Creator God, you designed the entire universe and called it good. Hinder those who would cause further destruction to our planet's fragile ecosystems, and augment the calls of those who advocate for thoughtful stewardship of the earth's resources. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Holy Spirit, you raise up leaders committed to love and justice. Nurture in those who govern patience to receive criticism, openness to new ideas, and courage to change course when needed for the sake of the common good. We especially pray for Chris Brown, Tyler Barnes, Andrew Devine, Darian Doan, Carson Kozlowski, Joshua Kozlowski, Rusty Landry, Christopher Morgan, Ben Painter, and Ryan Schiffner. Protect Officer Sam Kandel as he works in our neighborhood to establish peace and harmony. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Father, we are saddened by the war in Ukraine. Please make everyone involved to repent of aggression and violence. Send your Holy Spirit to work in the hearts of leaders and give them wisdom so that peace and justice can prevail. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Dear Jesus, you hear us when we cry to you. Attend to those expecting a child, and console those who have experienced miscarriage. Comfort veterans enduring post-traumatic stress. Shield those endangered by domestic violence. Uphold those who are ill or grieving. Just as you kept your promise to Abram, we trust that you will keep your promise to always be with us. There are so many members of our congregation that need to feel your presence. We especially pray for Marianne Allen, Virginia Bauman, Mary Brenke, Tasha Brisbow, Marv Cole, Crystal Collins, Doug Griffin, Emma Hicks, Amy Hunter, Rhoda Hunter, Marilyn Bass Heiser, Nancy Jackson, Carol Kinky, Marilyn Kostruski, Michael Mahoney, Linda McClellan, John Nelson, Yvonne Nelson, Don Olson, Theron Palmer, Gloria Robbins, Carol Roush, Connie Scott, Audrey Skidmore, Ken Teeter, Betty Van Conant, Cheryl Van Patten, Emily Veely, Shelby Waters, Matthew White, and Marion Wilford. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Heavenly Father, you kindle faith that moves us into action. Bless the work of the Pine Ridge Retreat Center in South Dakota. Strengthen our bond with our Baker neighborhood partners and work through our food bank as we spread your love to those around us. Guide children and adults preparing for baptism and or confirmation. Empower Sunday school teachers, confirmation leaders, and parents who share their faith with younger generations. Give us all a renewed sense of vocation. Merciful God, receive our prayer.
We pray for a member recently diagnosed with cancer, coming to terms with what that might mean for her. And we pray for Chris White, great nephew of Mel White and Mary Bartell. Chris cut off four of his fingers while he was working this week. And we pray for Gina DeWitt, Ginny Garatina, Wendy Prattley, Matt Anderson, Caleb Crawford, and those we now name before you in our hearts. Merciful God, receive our prayer. You welcome us into your heavenly realm. We give thanks for those whose labors on earth are ended and who now rest with you. On the final day, gather all of us with them in your loving arms. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Accept the prayers we bring, O God, on behalf of a world in need, for the sake of Jesus Christ. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Please greet one another with the word of God's peace and love. And as you do so, we will receive our offering and a second offering for the Lutheran Lakota Shared Ministries at the Pine Ridge Reconciliation Center. And we'll hear the anthem solo from Lisa Whitman, Love God, Love People.
I've been running in circles, jumping the hurdles, getting caught up in the rush of doing so much. I feel kind of worn out, all this checking the boxes, trying to be flawless, has me spinning in my head, catching my breath, too afraid to slow down. I tell myself to keep this up, that God wants more than just my love, but I've been complicating things. It's just like me to overthink. Gotta keep it real simple,
keep it real simple,
bring everything right back to ground zero. Gotta keep it real simple. Rescues hearts and changes lives. Love is all we need to make things right. Gotta keep it real simple. Oh, it's really so simple. Oh, oh, gotta keep it real simple, real simple. Bring everything right back to ground zero. Is it all? But if we want to find a way to change it, it all comes down to this, love God and love people. Oh, keep on loving, keep on giving, keep on sharing, love God and love people. So give of yourself, lift others up, it's all about love, it's how we change the world. Love God and love people.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, even as you stoop to gather all your children to yourself, so have we gathered these gifts to you. We offer them with love. Use them for your kingdom. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Gathered as one in the Holy Spirit, we pray as Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And our sending hymn is, For the Bread Which You Have Broken.
Thank you.
Go in peace. Jesus meets you on the way. Thanks be to God.